How long did you stay last night?
6 hours.
6 hours? Oh, not too bad. Okay, yeah. And how did it go?
It went bad. We forgot only one type of equipment.
You forgot what?
Only one shovel.
Really? So. Good, good. Okay. It can be much worse. And what about the other groups? Did you go out and see them in the field? Yeah? Okay. Yeah. Because tomorrow it's on again, right? Did you feel like you knew what you were doing when you were out in the field? Yeah, okay, right, yeah, yeah. And last night at the lab, it was okay. Right. All right. This is going really well. No, because when we first started this whole series of working with the Comuna, we had to figure out what people will learn and what people won't learn and remember and so on and so forth. So over the years, it's gotten much more organized. So this response makes me feel, oh my God, you've done something right. So very, very good. This means, okay, because there's already two groups who've gone out and they have their materials and methods now, in fact. They just haven't written it down. The second hour of this class will be that they write their materials and methods. And they get a draft before 10 o'clock today. Okay, so they will have a draft of materials and methods today. If you want to stay and learn how to do it so that you're taking the right notes tomorrow or your field day, do so, okay? Because it'll be a very basic run through, and it's also using stuff that's loaded up to the student portal already. But we also have this abstract deadline. Before we get into that, I'm going to just do the roll call, and then we'll get into that. Okay, Jennifer, Cassandra, Prakash, not yet. Osna, Osnavi, not yet. Sarah, Marie. Yes. Aurelien? Yes. Yeah. Hilda? Yes. Hassan? Vega? Not yet. Gudni? Yeah. Sigrid? Yeah. Ket? Not yet. Egor? Yeah. Ingrid? Andreas? Tygve? Not yet. Nicholas?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ingalil?
Yeah.
Okay. Daniela? Winnie? Jana? Not yet. Vilde? Not yet. Steve? Not yet. Kanti? Yes. Marie? Hege? Ruhua? Yes. Sondra? Yes. Carlotta? Evan? Not yet. Jan-Uwe? Tan? Not yet. Looks like there's a bee bomber that's going to be coming in. Some of them now. Sissa?
Yes.
Marek? Lynn? Not yet. Tubor?
Yeah.
Olina?
Yeah.
Sondra?
Yeah.
Hanna?
Yeah.
Marie?
Yeah.
Jocelyn?
Yeah.
There we go. And Tuna? And Chris?
No.
Yeah, there we go. Okay. I noticed yesterday, when I looked yesterday, seven of you had already uploaded your abstracts to the website as in they were delivered. How many of you have done so now? Right. Okay, some of the missing. Yeah, okay. And how many of you actually started? Okay, good. Have you made a first draft out? Yeah? Are you happy with it? Right. Okay. Because this is fairly easy. Orvelin, if you don't mind that I use yours, because I read yours yesterday. And it's, okay. And this is the one that isn't the easy, this is the biohackers one, okay? And there was two in the class who said that the biohacking was difficult. Yes or no, it doesn't really matter, but what's interesting here is whether or not you get the point across. I hate this thing. By the time we get to this point here, is that one going to go? There we go. So let's see. So there was only, how many of these of you read the biohacking one where I had to do it? Okay, yeah, good. I'm using Orvelin's because I looked at it yesterday, not a lot terribly wrong with it and so on. And now those who haven't read it, let me see. See, there's that review thing here. I want to show final without the markup. Okay, so let's see what we can get. See if I can reduce this a bit. No, I can't. There, okay. Take a look, and it's under 500 pages of words. Sorry, I haven't had coffee this morning. I'm a disaster. Okay, the reason I'm focusing on this is because the function of an abstract is different than the function of a summary, and it's different than the function of a conclusion. When you're reading, when you're looking for articles, when you were doing that search with the library, what were you searching for?
Keywords,
right. And then you get up stuff that obviously by the title is not what you're looking for. Okay, you might get a title, and if you clicked on that, you'd get the beginning of an abstract. So basically, the only things that are selling your article in the 2.5 million that are published this year, the only thing selling your article is the title and the abstract. That's it. But they are written last. Okay? And that this means that in that abstract, you have to tell them some very fundamental things. There's a difference between a descriptive abstract and an informative abstract. We are generally dealing with the sciences. This is not necessarily a science abstract, so the format is correct. And what we have to do is the informative abstract. But either way, the abstract tells you about the content of the paper. It doesn't add new information, and it doesn't add a new perspective. It tells about the content of the paper. So I'll turn off that light. Have a read and see if, and then talk amongst yourselves. Good morning. That was that, Vibana. So have a read, and then in 3 minutes, I'm going to ask randomly somebody to say their impression of what the paper was, and preferably not somebody who did biohacking. Okay. And when you get down to the bottom, let me see, maybe I'll. just going to try and reduce the font a bit. Sorry. Can you still read it?
No.
Okay. Sorry. Okay, tell me when I have to scroll down. Scroll? Yes? No?
Sorry, I cannot read.
Why?
My eyes are not
good. Move. You can even stand here if you want. Okay, done? Okay. So, whoops. Tell me what it was about. Somebody who isn't doing the biohacking one, what was the article about? What was the whole point of it?
It was about trying to bring to the forefront the idea that science is being taken over by political and corporation money, basically, mm-hmm. and that it's no longer a noble profession. It's basically a very opinionated editorial piece without any sources cited, and it's basically garbage.
Okay, except that was the abstract from the biohacking article, okay,
yeah.
So, which was a book.
Right.
Yeah, did you read the book? No.
No.
Okay, but as that abstract was just right there, that gave you the idea that that it was putting up the corporate idea of science. Yes?
Yeah.
Okay. The idea that you would give a feeling about whether or not that article, because it wasn't an article, it was Orwell Ian who wrote it, it was a summary, an abstract of, the extended abstract of one of the three articles that you have.
Okay.
Okay. So. Bibana, and I know I'm lacking coffee. Probably you are too. But okay, good. You got the discussion started. Who got something else out of it? Yes.
It does was about the ethic points of using people as an example for doing research, and also how to explore the data of the research resource.
Okay. Okay. Anybody else? Yes.
I think there was a clear idea about helping some
data for the popular, but to keep the right for the inventors.
Yes, yeah, that's one of the ideas. And but it's also not saying, it's not coming down clearly on one side or the other, is it? It's describing a new situation.
Yeah.
And that new situation is in fact quite real. So this, you know, when I got some of the feedbacks, some of you weren't happy with the articles I gave you. Tough. But because the point is that those articles are relatively new and give a summary, a very broad summary, of the landscape of science now. And I gave it to you partly to see how well you could write, and Lord knows I hope you write well, but also to see if you can get the ideas that are in these articles up and across. Okay. So Orleans abstract, an extended abstract, what was it, 337 words, something like that. Yeah. A normal abstract is 250, yours is up to 500. It's difficult. It's difficult to put all those ideas down, but the ideas that are in that abstract are the ones that make you want to read the rest. Okay. So the ideas that Orlean got through to you, now you can see the difference between what you write and what gets understood, because you're apparently full of shit. but not as a summary article. I'm sure this is going to be copied later on. But also, I mean, that's the approach many people will have to what you write. So what you want to do is get the idea across that is central in the paper. You also want to make the person want to read your article, make it relevant, and make it and make it informative. So there's let me see, do I have it up here? This one here. Okay. In this case here, if it comes up, yes, there it is. Okay. I'm going to load this one up to the website. Because it looked to me, it's a really good and concise idea of what an abstract is, and why we write it and so on. How to do it, that's fine. The important part here is that it's a... Can I have a pointer? Does anybody see a pointer? No.
Is it going to use a mouse?
Yeah, I'm going to have to. Right. Okay, the descriptive abstracts, that's basically what you can be doing with these three articles. With the other ones that are coming, you're going to be doing these informative abstracts. So in an informative abstract, science, engineering, or psychology reports. And that's because it highlights these things, the method used. And even Aurelien wrote down, they investigated it using the hacker ethical model. And although it wasn't explained what that is, and it wasn't in the article either, it does say how it was done. You'll notice that these more descriptive ones for the social sciences don't go on method used. Part of that is because the standardization of methods has become more common with the natural sciences. Okay, but that means that your abstracts are going to have at least one sentence about the background for the study. So the background. And in fact, Orlean's first paragraph didn't start with this book. It started with an overall view, and then the second paragraph said this book. So you had already an introduction to the topic, much broader, and then down into this book. And that's just fine. Because in your abstracts here, you set the stage, and then you say what went on. So you have, in a way, an introduction, a broad introduction, not this article, but the broader introduction. And so it's that sentence, in a way, the simplest formula is one sentence times intro, one sentence times M&M, one sentence times results, and maybe two sentences times discussion. But importantly, there is that final sentence. Okay. Does Does everybody have their abstract with them in some form or another right now? How many don't? Not even with, oh, there's not that many. Okay, listen. In fact, until the break at 9, let's work for real on these, on your abstracts. So bring out what you've got now, because our intention isn't to make you fail. Our intention is to make you get as good a grade as possible on the real objective criteria. So if you've got your abstract here, bring it out. Oh, yeah, sure. And this also means that those who want to revise whatever they uploaded before can do so, okay? So, and you don't have your abstract here?
No, not here.
Okay, does that mean you actually didn't start it?
No, I finished it.
You finished it, okay. Okay, so get yours out, and then hand it to the person beside you. Okay? So hand your rough draft abstract to the person beside you. Right. Find somebody. Oh, materials and methods. Oh, yeah.
Based on a set of works of scientists in history.
Some of them, yes.
Economy and welfare.
Ah, okay. So you actually did a summary, not an abstract. Okay. Okay, I wasn't specific, so we'll accept that. But if you don't mind, I'll make a point of it. Because that means that in your abstract you did references, which is not really an abstract. An abstract doesn't give new information.
We have maybe an abstract of a book.
Okay. Yes.
So
in a way, but that was just a portion of a chapter that I gave it. And I know it was difficult. Okay, I wasn't specific in the rules, and that's wonderful. Can I take yours up as a no, I won't, because it'll just confuse them. But I'll keep that in mind when I'm grading. If you want to change it, go ahead. But otherwise, I'll review it on its own merits. Okay? Yeah. No, it's not 100% science, and neither was either of the other two. They were not scientific papers either.
It's
possibly, yes, it was. But some people did a good job, probably you too. Yeah. Okay. Yep. You're going. Good. Exactly. What did you, when you read, what do you understand? Tell the writer. Okay? And if you're alone, why don't you, Yonova, why don't you go, Ego, why don't you go back to Yonova? Because he's sitting by himself there too. Okay. So I'll give you about till 10 to. And a couple of things I want you to take to, if it is unclear writing, in English, it helps to clarify if the distance between the noun, the subject, and the verb is short. Okay, so this means, you know, the dog ran. The distance between the noun, the dog, and the verb ran is very short, obviously. But if you say, the dog who had da 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 and four letters and then ran, that's a very long distance between the noun and the verb. And especially in scientific writing, and especially in abstracts, put them together if you're using that verb, and also make it clear. No fluffy words, information dense, but clear. Okay. No fluffy setting the stage stuff. Be clear. Keep the words short, information dense, good writing, and lead with the first couple of words of each sentence. Okay. I'll give you till 10-2 to give each other reactions.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll just go with the person next to me. Okay, thank you. Or something something very positive. Okay. So now you've been talking a bit and found out what was the difference between what you wrote, what was understood by the reader of the abstract, and what was written in the article that you summarized in the abstract, right? Found some gaps there?
A lot.
Yeah, right. Very good, because in fact, this is the hardest thing to learn, that what you write, because now you're not writing for me, well, you are, but not necessarily. You're not writing to get a grade and to please me and my standards. You're writing for comprehension. And there is a huge difference between what you write and what gets understood. Because when we write with the understanding between the lines. And when that between the lines is not passed on through the writing, then the reader gets another understanding. It's really, really difficult. So this is perfect that you found out there was a big difference between what you meant and what was understood. That is perfect, and that's the point of this little exercise here, to sort of get things. And you guys are smiling. What did you find? You went off on some discussion about beer, I'm sure. No, what happened to you? You discussed the article? Perfect. Perfect. Anybody else do that? Discuss the article itself?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. Perfect. Because the article is the basis, and then you're putting your summary on top of it, and hopefully are contributing to the understanding of the reader. Okay? And so now that you've understood what gap there is between what you wrote, what you understood from the article, and what the reader of the abstract understood, you're getting a taste of how difficult it is to get your point across. Okay. The question is, did you have a point when you wrote the summary, the abstract? And most likely you did. But now, this means you have, 36 hours to make an improvement on this and to make the clarity of your communication even better, okay? So now I'm not going on you in terms of how exactly you reproduced the article, but rather how well you communicated the understanding of the article. And that's a different thing altogether. It also will dramatically affect your abstracts when you are writing your own. Because if you remember, this is the last thing you write. It's the thing that will, on the web, sell your article, make other people interested, warn them whether or not you are very pedantic and working so much in microbiology and molecular biology that if you're dyslexic, you've got a real problem, or whether the writing itself carries such clarity that you really want to read the entire article. Okay? So this means that for those who got some tips, and I really hope you did. Did you? Did you get it? Yeah. See? Ah, wonderful. You guys are so good. This is going to be such an easy class.
Can I say something? I have to say a conversation on the day that we received the articles, mm-hmm. and now, and I compared to a conversation, and I realized that on the first day, we have only a few minutes to read,
yes.
and write, and I think that I did a good job with summarize the main thing in the article.
Mm-hmm.
After a week's reading it,
mm-hmm.
I make it messy with a lot of information in that,
mm-hmm.
and that's the way I deal with the abstract writing,
mm-hmm.
now. It's a lot of information. I cannot pick the main things,
mm-hmm.
to put it in, and I was around everywhere,
mm-hmm.
with the article information. And also, when I tried, and also my friend tried,
mm-hmm.
to write abstract for the article, we don't follow exactly that structure.
Right.
This
That's
is
fine.
Kind of a storytelling,
yeah.
something like that. And the article tell everything.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know where should we go.
Right, okay. Did anybody else have trouble with that? Condensing the information? You did? Okay. All right, what's your main trouble?
So I got the New Zealand and it's a bit of like a story. It doesn't really, do you have that one too? It's a bit like a story kind of thing, and
mm-hmm.
then you want to put it all together and you think, I'm kind of, you're telling the story again, there's a point, but I'm not really, do you
right.
know, it's a bit too much information to get down to 300, 400 words.
Right, okay, and in when you're publishing, your limit will be 200 words. Yeah, so it's quite a challenge. But part of the point of this linking the abstract and a couple of exercises here is the first day, when I gave you really little time to do it, you were like, and, okay? And everybody was doing the best they could and complaining afterwards, we didn't get enough time. No, you didn't. And in fact, that was part of the point. Go through it. What is it that strikes your mind right away? And you have a record of what struck your mind right away when you were reading that article. And then you have as Lynn was talking about, the digested version now. And that differs again from what struck your mind first. And now compare what today's comments have been relative to what strikes the mind of the reader of your abstract compared to what struck your mind about the article first. And maybe some of the things that struck your mind first about the article are the things that are missing now in the understanding of the reader. Okay? So that's part of the idea that the highlights in the article, because they're relatively well written, they should be visible at the surface, quickly grasped. There's a lot below it, but a well-written article has the important parts quickly grasped. The important parts not buried in the middle of a paragraph, but up near the top. So you saw them, preferably, right away. And then somehow get them into the abstract, making it important, making it cohesive. And yes, there's a lot to each story. And then getting that over to the reader again. And this may be like a really basic exercise, but it is one where we're starting to work on making people understand complex stories. And this is one of the keys about science communication. People say, we have to simplify it. No, simplification isn't the idea. You know, dumbing down is not the idea. Not when we're communicating to other scientists in an abstract, not when we're communicating to other people. We're trying to communicate the ideas, and those are not dumb ideas, right? So this is now where you're working on the broader concept of communication, what the author was trying to get, and they generally got the high points to you first time around. And then you digested it and started to work your own texts, and maybe you lost it, maybe you didn't. Who read an abstract that was really good today? Who was really happy with the abstract they read? Okay, you read Sondra's?
Yeah, it was like it.
Okay. And Sondra's shaking his head. Yeah. Okay, Sondra, what did you feel could be better?
Sorry, to get all the points, because now I'm following the text
yeah.
point.
Oh, yeah.
And it's going like big and small and big and small. And
right.
It's hard to get from the big and to the small.
It's hard to get that flow, yes. And so that big and small, when you're making things information dense, you can put two smalls together in a way, if they fit. So can you give me an example of what you're talking about? Just read it out loud.
I have a New Zealand text.
Yeah?
But
we're making life easy for you, Justin. Don't listen.
From because there's so many examples in the text, and I have to like structure. I'm taking the examples from the text and just putting them into the, and then I'm like writing first example, second example, third example, and
you don't have to use the 500 words, you know.
No, but shouldn't I include all the examples that you're using? Like, if there are big.
We have a comment at the back then.
Because I've got the same paper and I saw the examples, I thought if I start summarizing each one of them, I'm kind of telling the whole thing in a way. So I just kind of went for New Zealand and the USA had this, and then New Zealand and I think they had another greenhouse example, but I just said it, but I didn't expand it at all.
Right.
I just thought I'd leave it there. But I don't know if that's a good way of doing it or...
Goodness.
Well, I had the same article, and for me the example was more like the method they used. So for me it would be just using that this article are using examples in order to get the point across, because I found the point to be very clear,
right,
the conclusion to be very clear. But then I more had the problem with getting in more words in a way, because sometimes it can get just too short.
But you know, like I said, the maximum 500 words. It doesn't mean has to be 500 words.
What's the minimum? What's the minimum?
We'll say 250.
Okay. I got a question about like indentation. Are we allowed to make a new indentation?
Oh, if you wanted to make paragraphs, yes. It's not uncommon to have paragraphs in extended abstracts. So that's fine.
It just seems much easier for a reader to manage.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
My friend, she talked about her article is really good, really understandable.
Yeah.
Just not finished writing, so.
Yeah.
But the way she wrapped the information in that is a good way.
Okay. Do you want to be detailed and a bit louder so they can hear?
Yeah.
And we're going to take a break after this comment.
She just picked out the general ideas of the articles.
Yeah.
And then some ideas support to that and. Just use examples in a short way, not to describe the detail, very detail about the examples.
Okay, so there's obviously no one right answer, but it is the conveyance of communication and the clear understanding that the reader gets that is the important part. And now you understand how varied the responses of a reader can be. And this is your peer group, so therefore your abstracts have already been peer reviewed, and now you're going to revision. Okay? So technically, that's what's already happened. We'll take a break of 15 minutes, and I'll see you back here at 20 past. Okay?
This is how he gets back to you. This is how he is.
I'm just trying to.
Did you like
yeah.
write
so
about
like, I want to put my. I don't like that word.
Yeah.
Just
that's just more like.
But that's common.
But I was wondering if, because you want to make 1 250 hours. Okay. You want
in general, I guess. I think it tries to just a but it only shows examples, which is not everybody. Yeah, but of course, then I can engage them. But actually, I just want to ask them your feeling or your idea, or your opinion about the idea of the absence or their main focus on the challenges of usually as a solution, or talking about the advantages as a
solution.
That's what it said in the article, but from Swedish, it's also talking a lot about how the
quite
different from. Not necessarily being its own country, but how science is used as a currency to.
Yeah.
Are we all back? Is anybody missing? Are we all back? Okay. Okay, there's just for those who are writing and going to be submitting their materials and methods shortly. We've also made a standard page format for all the reports, because you probably noticed by now that there is. And that standard page format, I loaded up to the website today. It's got the site at the top and the year, and then at the bottom it has the bio UIB group number, whatever it was, and then your names. The order of the names is up to you to decide. Okay, and sometimes sometimes it's alphabetical, sometimes it's according to effort, sometimes the rules of what order of names you have, it's up to you. But do remember that whoever gets that spot there becomes this name et al. In all the other references, just so you know. Okay? I should have brought it. Anyway, okay, you laughed in recognition, right? Because there's that spot. There's that spot. And that's the attitude people have to their written production. And the attitude, the possessive attitude, I haven't told you about Monty Python, have I? No, good. Okay. If I had the text, I would read it to you. And it's a sketch with Miss Ann Elk. Okay. And this is a talk show. So you have Miss Ann Elk sitting here like so. And you have the interviewer over here. We have today with us Miss Ann Elk, who is to present us her new theory about the Brontosaurus.
May I just say, Chris, thanks that I have a new theory about the Brontosaurus, which is mine.
Yes, that's what I just said.
Yes, Chris, well, you may. This theory, that is mine.
Yes, well, we are here to let Miss Elk present her theory about the Brontosaurus.
Yes, oh yes, thank you very much, Chris. What I'm about to present is mine and what it is too, and this is my theory, and we will begin now. My theory about the Brontosaurus by Ann Elk, brackets, Miss Brackets. This theory, and what it is mine, and what it is too. My theory about the Brontosaurus, it begins now.
Chris by now is getting very upset, but she says,
Brontosauruses are thin at one end, much, much bigger in the middle, and thin at the other end.
That's your theory, is it?
Yes, and mine, and it belongs to me, and yes, it is mine.
Well, it seems to have hit the idea right on the head.
Yes, thank you very much, Chris. It took a lot of work.
Now for the next item on the wasp factor.
I have a theory number two.
And she wants to continue, but she's made a point that it is mine. And the work that you put into this is mine, or yours. and that ownership of ideas is very important, okay? So even when you're working in teams, remember, this is your first place where you're going to have to do a little teamwork about what goes where, who goes where, literally. And this is the kind of decision that gets taken every single day among teams of scientists who are doing big things. Now, when I say teams of scientists, I mean teams of scientists. The abstract you read first this morning about biohacking and so on, that talked about the new era of big science and sharing data and possibly hacking and so on. For example, one of the big science things we all know about is the Large Hadron Collider in CERN, right? Do you know what papers coming out of there look like? And I'm not kidding. They can be 36 pages. A primary scientific article coming out of CERN about the Large Hadron Collider, experiments done there. 36 pages. No, 34. And the first 26 pages are author names. Okay? So there are hundreds of papers with over 1,000 authors on them. And there are more papers now. There's more papers now with over 5,000 authors on them. So we're giving you a little taste of literally the tip of the iceberg, okay? And it gets that complex. So your idea of somebody writing, sitting down and writing alone, it still happens. It still happens. Single author papers, they still happen. But in areas of complex science, big numbers, big numbers. You know, an average number of scientists, right, is five, like what you're going to be here. Five working in small institutions. When you're getting, if you guys get up into the bigger projects and so on, 20 authors, easy peasy. 1,000, you begin to wonder. 5,000, who did what on the paper? Okay, anyway. So, we're going to get into the materials and methods. Okay, and this is the first thing you write, and it will be, it's pretty straightforward. So, there's a couple of sections in here, and I opened up, close that. And on the website, under fieldwork, written report, aids, and so on, we have how to write a master's thesis. 11 of you have gone in there already and taken a look. That's fine. In under there, we have this, and the basic guideline. For writing, there's the abstract thing. And here's materials and methods, okay? Materials and methods, it's the structure. And the structure is like this, okay? So there's a bit of text that it tells you about it, but the structure is like this. So right now, right here, write a paragraph, those who've been out in the field, write a paragraph about where you were. Basically, right here, right now, just do it. You don't even have to write a paragraph, but get your thoughts down on paper. We're going to get it structured so that you know what, so we've got everything in that paragraph already. So I know that there's a number of you who haven't been out in the field, but you know where it is. Some of you have already been there, taken a look. And so you can get this down anyway.
Should we get into our groups and do that there?
You can do it now. If were you out yesterday? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Do it now. For real. Do it now. Yeah. You don't have to, because we're going to be going fast enough through it that if each one makes their own version, together, you've got everything. Okay? So this is just an exercise. Instead of sharing responsibility, everyone takes full responsibility for this exercise, and when it's done, you put it together and you decide who's got the best. Okay? So that's easy. Okay. So I know that some people are thinking of working in groups, and for the materials and methods section, and for those who haven't been out already, I'll do the exercise in a group with you if you need it, again. Take individual responsibility for all of this now, because when you get together in a group, some people have remembered something and some people have remembered something else. And then as five individuals who've taken individual responsibility, there you will have almost the whole thing, okay? So it's really darned easy. So, write a description of your site. And what it looked like. We'll give you a couple of minutes. I can tell by your heads when you're done, because we're going on to a next thing after that.
Nobody else.
Google Drive is
You're
awesome.
Fine.
They can see what I'm adding to the file. And I said hello.
Okay, ready for the next step? I got some nods. Does anybody need a lot more time? No? Yes? No? Next step? When you're talking about the sampling sites, one of the first things you can tell us is how many sampling sites there are, okay? Some places might have 7, some places might have 3. Let us know early on how many to expect. Remember, this text is supposed to be information dense, not a lot of fluff, and really concise and be understood. Basic information? It is, but it's sometimes so basic information, people forget it. And even last year with all the stuff, with all the TA help and so on, there was one report that got all the way to the final submission and didn't tell me where they were. So it's so basic, people forget it.
But all sides have concrete walls.
Yeah. Walls, yes.
Sides 1, 2, 3. Like all contours of the lake. Actually, I don't need to write that. I just say the lake is surrounded by concrete wall, and then it's just assumed all sides.
Yeah. And there's not many people going down to the water.
Then we can go over to the next step in this, which is what type of samples were taken. How many? How many types of samples? Okay, and in this case, you can do like We took 7 different types of samples. The abiotic with probes. So you just basically list it, and then after that you go describe sampling methods. Okay. This is the hard part, okay? Because you want to, this part here is the part that is supposed to be replicable. Okay? In the scientific method, you're supposed to be able to replicate a study. This part here should be so clear that you could let somebody read it and do it again. So when you're describing, for example, the kick sampling, you say, we were at this spot, the water was so deep, somebody held the bucket 2 meters away or whatever, or 30 centimeters away, and we kicked for a minute. And the sediment was sieved through the bottom, and all animals retained were analyzed in the lab for species or down to the lowest available descriptive level, okay? When it comes to E. coli, also explain how you took the samples, so it's pretty simple. And you're going to end up stopping at delivered to von Lubb. But there will be a description of how that E. coli sample was treated after you handed it over. And I want you to put that into your materials and methods in the final version. And there will be also a description of what happens to the phosphorus samples after you delivered it to Evofins. You will put that in there. But right now, just describe what you yourselves are doing. Okay? So if you've decided not to use nitrate, that's fine. That's not on your list. If you've decided to do only water column samples, that's fine. That means that's on your list, and you're describing how. So you've got at least 3 clear methods that you have to describe, and you have to describe what else you sample, the information you get, from the pH, to the temperature, to the oxygen, to the salinity. How you even got the random selection of the sediment that you looked at? Yes.
I was just wondering, since we might have several sets, but then we have different amounts. So we're doing some samples on one site and not all of them on the second site, for instance. So
that's fine.
Be like we're doing 7 oxygen sampling on site 1, mm-hmm. and then 10 phosphorus on site 1, 2, 3.
So you mean spread evenly over site 1 to 5 or something like that?
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine. If not every site gets the same sampling treatment, just say so at the end of the paragraph about the sampling methods. Remember, it's the clarity of the information that you put across that's really key here, and that each sampling site does not get the same treatment. That's fine.
Should I just mention that there and not like in the sites because we're going to do site descriptions, right? So it shouldn't include. So site 1, and we're doing all of these different samples here, and then site 2, we're doing all of these there. I should instead do like.
People have to know where the sites are, then they have to know what you were doing, what methods you were doing, and those have to be clear. And if you want to repeat where these ones were placed, that's fine. Or if you want to have a separate little sentence that says biodiversity was only sampled at sites 1 and 4, for example, that's fine. But you have to tell us, okay? Because now materials and methods is the basics part of the paper. It's the part that's supposed to be written so clearly that it is reproducible. And this is the part you went to for the previous reports to look at what they did on their sites and so on, and you've got complaints about what they wrote and so on. But they were trying as hard as you to make it clear. Yes?
Can we include a map?
Absolutely. Pictures, maps, everything's fine. But remember, there's one key thing. If you have a picture or a map, it has to have a label on it, figure 1 or figure 2, whatever. It also must be referred to in the text. It's not a magazine picture. It's not just for decoration, it's for use. And if the text doesn't use it, it goes out. And if it doesn't, if it has no real informative value, might be a pretty picture, it might show animals grazing and so on, that's fine, mostly for your presentation. The informative aspect of the pictures is what's clue. So when you're out there taking the films or the pictures and the recordings, whatever it is, it's the information that you pass along that's clue. The text must always refer to the figure you use. And if you want to make a table with an overview, that's absolutely fine as well. Refer to the table in the text. You probably already done that.
Could I mention some limitation on
assessment by choosing? Yeah, sure. You can, but it's not a big point. You chose what you chose, and you can justify it, but half a sentence. If something was inaccessible, or if for the sediment it was only rocks there and it was bare, that's fine. Generally in the methods part, because people, when they read that, they need to find out a little bit of why. You know, and generally the sites, why for you? So in some cases, in experimental designs, animals die. So one group died, or half of the control group died. So that is what you have to work with, and you have to write around it. And materials and methods is actually where you say that. In other cases, time limitations for in biology things die, but time limitations for sometimes equipment goes off, and sometimes for example pH meter, in those sense things like breaks. So you have pH measurements for three sites but not seven. So these things happen, it goes into the biodiversity analysis. That means everything that happened after you sampled it. And for the bacteria and the phosphorus, I know that you delivered it, but we'll want a small description there. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
and by this point we're actually at processing of material, the third bottom one there. And on the side here, I've pointed out that this is written for experiments. You don't have a control group, it's a field group, so this is a field M&M, materials and methods, not an experimental M&M. So there's some deviation from the recipe.
How deep was that two again?
60.
Yeah, I said if you went further away, I think it was. Constant is the statistical analysis, and this is the part you'll be writing last. But for this, we will want things that it's already stated there. The programs that you use, for example, R or another program. What kind of tests you did. So it doesn't help to tell me we used R, but you have to say this kind of data was treated to ANOVA. This kind of data, the means were just compared via a t-test. Things like that. So those kinds of things are going in the last paragraph. You don't write it in the first draft. You will after you've done the results. Okay? And just to tell you how basic this is, there was a group that forgot the statistics paragraph last year when they handed in their final report and they had to revise. Okay? So it's that basic. It's like, oh yeah, my name is. Yes. Okay? So it's that basic, don't forget it. Yeah, I wrote that. I wrote it in the first paragraph. And then you need to reorder these, but it's more than this.
Oh, for what? For the what? That page, I'll
For a second, I put pigeons, doves, and seagulls in the home around the lake. Add accordingly for an empty weather on the day was cool, around 90 degrees Celsius. I'll have to make sure all the ready stuff is shipped on the end. But at the end, we can adjust the whole day and we'll take care of how they fly. We'll take a nap. If you don't know, you have to consider it.
Just one thing. When you're submitting the draft of the materials and methods, Lua reminded me, okay, there is your standard page format now. So it's uploaded. There it is. Change that. Change that. Fill in that. And that will be the format you use for all submissions from now on, okay?
Okay.
Okay. It's already loaded up. It's right there. Written, it's under written report aids, okay? So all that kind of stuff there. And that means that you now have a peer review of your extended abstract that will help you revise for the deadline on Friday, okay? So peer review can be as easy as that, but the idea is get your point across in a minimum amount of words. And then I'll be checking for the standard stuff. Like spelling and grammar and all that stuff, which is dreadful when English is not your first language. I just want clarity. I don't want flowery words, and I don't need big words. I need clarity of thought. And clarity of thought shows in any language. Okay? So exercise that. I'm not going to be impressed by your vocabulary, maybe. But I am hopefully going to be impressed by your clarity of thought and how it got down on the page in less than 500 words. Okay? That's it. See you Friday.
If it isn't in the schedule, There's dirt there.
Yeah, that's good.
But it's kind of